cooperation for achieving water security. And here, water security is also linked to sustainable development. So either sustainable development is based on water security, and also water security is based on sustainable development. So we have the 17 SDGs, and there are many people who are talking about water is the core of the 17 SDGs. For example, some people, they believe that it is the main driver of the 17 SDGs. But let us look at the definition of water security. Let me read it. Water security is defined here as the capacity of a population to safeguard sustainable access to adequate quantities of acceptable quality water for sustainable livelihood, human well-being, and socioeconomic development, for ensuring protection against waterborne pollution and water-related disasters, and for prevailing ecosystem in a climate of peace and political stability. It's almost everything. It includes the society, the economy, the environment. That's why people, they believe it is in the core of the SDGs and it's the main driver. I believe actually in a different model. I believe to achieve water security, there are some basics you have to have. For example, we can cluster the SDGs that enable water scarcity, and there are other SDGs that depend on water scarcity. So you can see them as input and output. So for water scarcity, you need the people to be educated. So you need to integrate water education in your education system in order to have people who support you to achieve water security. You also need to include these different SDGs that are enable water scarcity. But once you have water scarcity, you can achieve the rest of the SDGs. There is no hunger without achieving water security. There is no the clean water and sanitation without having the water itself, without having the water security. So almost 50% of the SDGs are the main drivers for water scarcity, water security, but water security itself will enable us to achieve the other SDGs. Here is the problem, how to start, and how can you achieve all of that by the year 2030? And this is really the big challenge. Now we will transfer this challenge to speak about water security to our distinguished professor, Professor Van Peek. He is a water resources specialist who graduated in 1972 from Delft University of Technology in Civil Engineering. He worked in the Middle East as hydrologist for the UN. He joined Delft Hydraulics in 1976, and which is now known to all of us as Deltaris. He carried out several projects in the Netherlands, but also in many countries around the world, particularly in Asia. Several years of experience in IWRM, Integrated Water Resources Management Model, modeling. He participated also in the first National Water Resources Plan of Egypt and in several other consultancy activities. He has a teaching position at the Technical University of Delft, one of the top 50 universities globally, and he is also teaching for the IHE Delft, that was formerly the UNESCO IHE. So now we hand over to Professor Van Peek to cover the cooperation for filling and operation of reservoirs, but also focusing on water security related issues and explaining us how can we achieve water security and in the relation to transboundary rivers. Professor Van Peek, you have the floor.
Thank you, Dr. Hanke. Yes, indeed. My presentation will be about water security, which you just introduced. And I'm sharing my screen now. Yes. And I'm focusing on this part, the water security and the cooperation, and a little bit related to the session also with the filling and operation of reservoir from a system perspective. But the starting point is that water security. The water security which you just introduced, Dr. Hani. I use a different definition here, but it is about the same, the availability of acceptable quantity and quality of water for health, livelihoods, ecosystems and production, coupled with an acceptable level of water-related risk to people. UN Water has another definition about the same. To the right shows a graphical presentation of water security, which is clarifies for me a lot. You have the drinking water is part of it, the economic activities that need to be supported, the hazards, the ecosystems, but also, and that is a nice feature of the UN approach, is that it has the, let's say, the higher elements, the good governance, the financing, the transboundary cooperation, and the peace and political stability. They're all part of water security. And then, yes, how can we measure water security? Because we can talk about it. The Asian Development Bank has tried to quantify water security. They defined water security in five dimensions. The first dimension is rural household water security. The second one is economic water security. The third one is urban water security. The fourth one, environmental water security. And the fifth one is water-related disaster security. And all those elements together are needed to achieve water security. So, and how to achieve it? And how does cooperation, the title of our session, can contribute to water security? First of all, my point is that if we want to achieve water security, we have to pay attention to all the dimensions. And it means also that the cooperation to achieve water security requires to pay attention to all those dimensions. And in the same time, taking into account those what I call the higher elements of the UN water graphic, the good governance, the financing, the transboundary cooperation, the peace and political stability. Also elements that has been mentioned before. So if you start cooperating, you have to ask you the question, what is your water security, the water security of the cooperating partners? And Asian Development Bank has tried to do that for their area. And this is just an example. Asian Water Development Outlook at ADB has classified the water security in the 49 of their regional members in five stages. The lower stage is nascent. The higher stage is model, and the others are in between. So you have an evolution of water security. And what you see is that, and this is the situation 2020, is that you have only one country and that is Afghanistan, that is still in this nascent stage. And there is no country is modeled yet, and that is also logical, that there is no country model yet, because none of the countries are perfect. There are always drought and floods. But there are countries like Japan, Korea, Australia, New Zealand that are what we call effective. They have reached a certain stage, and other countries are in between. So knowing that what the water security in the countries are is important. And that brings me to this water security at river basin level, because we talk about an integrated approach that we need to achieve water security. And integrated water source management is actually about cooperation, the balancing of interest between sectors, but also between the regions. And we like to do that, preferable at the river basin level, because there where we can look at the full impacts of the water balance, the supply and the demand, and the upstream, downstream impacts. And for me, this picture to the left is still the way how I look at integrated water source management and water security. You put your river basin on the table, you collect all the stakeholders around the table and try jointly to decide about how to develop a management system. Of course, this is a very idealistic picture, but the point is that if you sit around the table discussing your river basin and look at all elements of water security of all regions. So that brings me a little bit closer to the main emphasis on water security, and that is now the water systems that has reservoirs in it. Water source management is about dealing with climate variability. That's what is behind our profession. Making water available at the right time and the right place and protect against water-related disasters. And reservoirs are an excellent means to deal with this climate variability. Of course, it has to be done with combination with other measures like irrigation system, water supply system. And we, of course, we have to take into account all the other effects that the reservoir might have on ecology, social, water quality, etc. Reservoirs are not perfect. They have also disbenefits. A benefit is also keeping in mind is the hydropower, the non-fossil energy that comes in out of it. So the point is that if you only look at the water balance, then having more reservoirs in the river basin is good. It gives you the ability to increase the overall performance of the system. And that's what you want to optimize. You want to optimize the total performance of your system. And that's where academics come in. There are so many models that are available to design the system and how to operate it, all based on our own mental models for predicting the impacts. There are hundreds of PhD theses written about reservoir optimization. All techniques are being used, the stochastic dynamic programming, etc. The main challenge we have to keep in mind for making this model applicable, and most models are not really applicable, is because they do not know very well how to deal with an uncertain future. And then the uncertain future is a short term. If you have to make a decision on the operation, you don't know what is coming in the coming months or the coming period, that the long-term uncertainty about socioeconomic developments, the climate change. And even more difficult it becomes when you have to decide in a system where different components are owned by different organizations, from the Ministry of Power and Ministry of Agriculture, or are located in different countries. So, but if you optimize it and if you want to cooperate to optimize it, you have to keep a few things in mind. And that is what you want to optimize is to, of course, increase the benefits, but in particular also decrease the damages that might occur if there are droughts. And those damage curves are often very exponential. And that is indicated in the figure to the left. The challenge is to avoid those extreme damages coming to the left side of this curve. And we do that, of course, already by applying hedging in reservoir operation. And that's not only from a water balance point of view, because if you're on the left of the curve, you often have also situations where you have social unrest. So what can you do? Keep the storage as simple as that, as high as possible. Then you're more flexible, you have less operation. But then you can also release additional water upstream if it is needed downstream. Now, this logic, you can try to optimize it from a perspective of the overall system. So what are the situations then? There are three situations. You can have that you have a system and there is a new reservoir and that has to be filled. You have the normal operation. The reservoirs are all functional and you have to operate it. And you have to have a situation where you have to refill the reservoirs after a period of long drought, taking all interest into account. Now, let's go over them. The cooperation during the filling of a new reservoir, the first one. The speed of filling depends on the hydrological conditions, if you want to cooperate. You have the wet conditions, evident conditions, dry conditions. And now, the wet conditions is simple. Fill them as soon as possible, that new reservoir, all will benefit from that. Evident condition can be more tricky. You can consider the downstream requirements by means of taking more years to fill or filling based on a percentage of the inflow or maintaining a minimum inflow. It gets more tricky even if you have dry conditions. And then the same approach should be followed as for average condition, but then you can consider that even during filling, you can consider to provide an extra release from the dam to meet downstream demands. And that is tricky, of course. You start to fill the dam, but during the filling process, you already release some water. But that is at the benefit of the downstream users, and they will benefit then from this new reservoir. And that can also lead to a situation where there will be a transfer payment involved because the upstream reservoir provides services to the downstream users. Now, during normal operation, you have the usual operation rules, trying to find the optimum benefit from the system, hydropower, agriculture, flood protection, etc. Important is that the downstream users need to know what to expect, and the low flows and the floods, so they are prepared for what's coming from upstream. Now, the usual thing is, of course, that reservoirs keep sufficient storage at the start of the wet season to accommodate floods, and you start hedging if your reservoirs are getting empty to take care of the dry conditions, or at least minimize the impacts of the dry conditions. But also, you can consider in terms of cooperation that the upstream reservoirs release more water to satisfy the condition downstream. Again, with the same percent of inflow, the minimum release, but also looking at those reservoirs, how much water is actually needed downstream. And again, what I said during filling, the upstream reservoirs provide services for the downstream users, and that can involve a transfer payment. A particular condition is during periods of a long time high or low flows. All river systems have that. Normally, we have 50 years or even 100 years of data available, and that shows already dry and wet periods. But using the statistic properties of those time series, you can make stochastic series that are much longer, and that shows more the phenomena involved. This figure shows the deviation from average. The line in the middle is the average, and everything that is up, there is more water, and what is down is less water. Now, this is 10,000 years. But if you look at more in detail on this one, and this is just a random example, and it is quite an exceptional random example, but this is one that we work with. Once we saw that during those long period, there are periods where there is a very long period of drought, and we should be prepared for that. Of course, this is a very extreme one, but those long periods of high and low flows will be there. And that's where this cooperation during the refilling of the reservoir of so long period comes in. And basically that is the same as for the filling of a new reservoir, but with the exception that in that case it is likely that all reservoirs will be empty. After such a long period of drought, all this was empty, yeah? And compared to filling a new reservoir, then the other reservoirs will be full, or at least have water. So, and then the situation, which normally is, if it starts to rain, upstream reservoirs start to fill, then the dry conditions for the downstream reservoir will continue. And then that filling of the upstream reservoirs, yes, that makes sense, of course, because most of the upstream reservoirs often have also a hydropower function, but an important hydropower function sometimes. But that refilling, the priority of upstream reservoirs, will have be at the expense of the downstream reservoirs. And that concludes more or less what I wanted to say, that in terms of cooperation for achieving water security, multi-reservoir systems provide excellent opportunities for cooperation. But please, if you discuss that, do that with all the dimensions of water security and not only the water balance. But if you do that, then all parties can benefit from such cooperation, because what I mentioned, having more storage can have an overall benefit for the whole system. Sometimes it will be needed that indeed downstreams pay for the service that are being provided from upstreams. The crucial condition that was mentioned also before was that full transparency is needed of the hydro conditions of the management rules. And that concludes my presentation. Thank you. I give back to the organizers.
Thank you. Thank you, Elko van Beek, for this very interesting presentation. I think you mentioned some very important key issues. The multi-reservoir operation itself as a concept that's internationally recognized idea to link dams and operate them together. Thank you for highlighting this. And I think the second very important point is also not to forget the refilling. The refilling might be more difficult than the filling, as we might come to this point later on. Thank you.